First on BBC Two, it's the 60s when freedom of speech for the reporter really got going.
We got 30 seconds.
Millions are watching.
The headlines at 6
o'clock. NBC News, Washington.
Right, stand by, everyone.
That's the X. All right, Scott, please.
Редактор газеты «Правда» вот.
We got 30 seconds. Ready, camera two.
By the early 60s, television in the United States had overtaken the newspapers as the place Americans turned to first for news.
The worst flood since World War II.
Live television, however, still had its pitfalls.
Already report refugees in the thousands. Walter Lister reports.
Don't forget, we're going right to Chicago, directly out of this. Stand by.
The request is passed. And in Louisville, this
will roll it! Punch Chicago!
There's a feeling that somebody goofed.
Somebody goofed
is right. There's supposed to be a flood control gate in this area.
Negative. Flip polarity. Flip polarity.
Some 80s scattered along the city's flood control.
In the Soviet Union, newsreaders were no longer fired for making mistakes, but the news was still censored and suffered from being broadcast at irregular times.
And that's what's causing London's police the headaches today.
It was in Britain where magazine programs had introduced more exciting styles of presentation, but television was making the greatest impact. But in all three countries, television journalists were about to enjoy a period of unprecedented power and influence.
What's that buzz?
Will you take camera two, please, Roger?
October the 8th, 1960, CBS's Chicago studio was being prepared for the first ever televised debate between presidential candidates, Richard Nixon and John Kennedy.
Yeah, let me see what we've got here. What the hell am I seeing?
Television was about to change the face of politics forever.
Kennedy arrived first, looking tan, handsome, well-tailored. You know, looked like the cover of some movie star magazine. Nixon had been suffering from an infection. He looked green and sallow.
Will you take camera one, please?
I said to Kennedy, "Do you want makeup?" Kennedy said, "No, I don't think I want makeup." Nixon heard Kennedy say that, and he figured if I have makeup, that's what they'll write about tomorrow morning. I was made up, he wasn't. So he said no, but he needed it.
The television and radio stations of the United States and their affiliated stations are proud to provide facilities for a discussion of issues in the current political campaign by the two major candidates for the
president. Nixon shouldn't have done it. He realized it was a psychological mistake. He was going to elevate this little-known senator to his level of prominence in one night. He realized he shouldn't have done it. I think that the realization of his mistake permeated his whole performance, made it poor that evening.
But our disagreement is not about the goals for America, but only about the means to reach those goals.
Everybody was being conditioned to think that Nixon would wipe the floor with Kennedy, that Kennedy was a callow young man. Well, when Kennedy stood there and didn't allow this to happen, he at least got on the same level with Nixon.
Well, the Vice President and I came to the Congress together, 1946. We both served in the Labor Committee. I've been there now for 14 years, the same period of time that he has. So that our experience in government is comparable.
The papers all said that Nixon had bested Kennedy in the debate. Because they've been listening to the radio. And I think you'll find, if you read the transcript of the debate, Nixon really did quite well. But if you watch the television, Kennedy ran away with it.
I think it's time America started moving again.
I always figured that night Kennedy was elected president, we didn't have to wait for election day. Is that the way to pick a president? No. That's the way you pick Miss America, Miss Universe, but I'm not sure that's how you pick a president.
Kennedy realized that his performance during the presidential debate had been a decisive factor in a close election. Once in office, he was quick to exploit the power of television further.
There was a time during the Kennedy years where the network, certainly at NBC, saw their White House correspondent almost as the NBC ambassador to the White House. It was almost that kind of relationship. So they expected friendly coverage, and they expected to see the network chiefs invited to dinner at the White House, and it was fairly cozy.
Mrs. John F. Kennedy, third youngest of the 29 wives to live in the White House.
For the first time, the cameras were invited inside the White House.
Mrs. Kennedy, I want to thank you for letting us visit your official home. This is obviously the room from which much of your work on it is directed.
Yes, it's attic and cellar all in one. Since our work started...
The relationship suited both press and president. Television bolstered Kennedy's popularity, and the glitz rubbed off on the reporters.
A little bit like an antique dealer's dream. Have you made any good finds lately?
This chest is rather interesting. It's something that belonged to a past president.
It made a fabulous picture, and the whole of America had its face against that candy store window pane, I think. They were the beautiful people, moneyed, fashionable, handsome, living the life everybody would like to live. So it made very good television.
The rest of the world was also transfixed. In July 1962, broadcasting history was made when the American networks and the European state broadcasters cooperated on the first satellite program.
I'm speaking from the International Control Room at BBC Television Center. In the middle of a chaos of wires and people shouting down microphones and watching monitor screens, the engineers are waiting here tonight to make television history.
The excitement of seeing live pictures from the United States, seeing the Statue of Liberty come up live on our screens, was huge. I mean, it was a major moment. And then the Americans, thanks to Fred Friendly as the executive producer, put on one hell of a good show. I mean, they gave us America live from coast to coast, such as they hadn't even seen.
We in television are convinced that the ability to portray immediacy, to realize what's new, what's going on, is the true significance of this new communications bridge. These first 18 minutes will attempt to show you a few of the things that are going on right now on the North American continent.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have just been informed that this baseball game is being seen in Europe right now over the Telstar satellite.
We understand that a moment ago, the President of the United States opened his weekly conference with Washington reporters. We take you now directly to the State Department building in Washington, where the President is...
The highlight was President Kennedy's press conference. It was a taste of how the satellite would be used in the future.
...on being the last ones to conduct nuclear tests because we were the first.
Well, the tests that we carried out were due to the breach of the moratorium by the Soviet Union last fall.
We always knew that the satellite would be used like Eurovision was used and had become used to major events, major sporting events, and news.
In the short term, jet travel had a greater impact. It made foreign reporting much easier.
I'm talking to you, in fact, at the moment from the wrong side of the line, from the communist side. But I only have...
Richard Dimbleby piloted the BBC flagship Panorama, but there were still places out of bounds.
Because the endangered frontier is this. this nail driven into the cobbles. On this side of it, a man dare not speak his mind. On that side of it, a man is free. Two worlds, separated here in the Potsdamer Platz, at any rate, by a single nail.
For British broadcasters, the line between what was and what wasn't permissible was being pushed back.
The 60s were marvelous for anybody working in television, largely because of the freedom we had. We were able to do things that were new, that were different, that were challenging.
Among the new programs was That Was the Week That Was, a Saturday night review of the week's news. Amazingly, it was produced by the BBC's current affairs department.
That was the week that was, it's over, let it go.
The programme was satire, humour and current affairs. It attacked the establishment of the day. It caused a sensation.
We thought we'd get about 2 or 3 million if we were lucky. But it struck a chord straight away because it was funny, it was much more irreverent than tonight. It was wicked at times.
That seat is marginal. If you want to get the vote.
Within 3, 4, 5 weeks, we had 12 million people watching it. And, of course, it caused trouble. It caused tremendous trouble. I mean, some of the sketches were right on the edge.
On Monday in Panorama, you may have seen a profile of the Prime Minister. One point, he crossed to a dispatch box, opened it, and revealed a copy of Roger's Thesaurus. Now, what word could he have been going to look up? Politics, do you think? Section 702 of Roger's Thesaurus, Penguin Edition, gives the following alternatives for that word. Cunning, craftiness, sharp practice, manoeuvring, chicanery, knavery...
When ITV, commercial television, came here in 55, ITV became us, and the BBC became them. And 1962, That Was the Week That was the first programme, that really the first programme in 7 years where people thought of the BBC as us against the great, big, faceless them.
And so there is the choice between the electorate and for the electorate. On the one hand, Lord Hume, and on the other hand, Mr. Harold Wilson. Dull Alec versus smart Alec.
Young people in Britain had been looking for something that attacked the concept that our elders were also our betters. They were our elders, but they weren't necessarily our betters. And that they were out of touch with the new generation and so on. And so they had been yearning, without knowing what it was, for something like That Was the Week That Was. And That Was the Week That was absolutely right for its time.
The heron folk are a standing joke with their shorts and hairy knees.
And the poor old Dutch do nothing much but smell very faintly of cheese.
An Italian boy says hello with a squeeze of finger and thumb.
Thank you.
So,
thank God for Englishmen and not common market, not common market, not common market scum.
I was present at a meeting of departmental heads where we were torn to shreds by the light entertainment people for putting this kind of muck out on the air. The governors all through the summer were chuntering about it and various edicts were issued.
The party's over.
That Was the Week That was short-lived.
Oh, hello. Today. They've burst your pretty balloon.
It was cancelled halfway through the second series, but the programme set the tone for the rest of the decade.
Now you must wake up.
There was going to be a general election. It was probably safer to take it off before that came than leave it up to the election run-up. So the programme ended early, but we knew without question that we'd made broadcasting history.
The party's over.
Innovation in current affairs wasn't confined to the BBC. The commercial television programme, which caused the greatest stir, came from Granada, based in Manchester.
There is a disease which in Britain causes more death and pain and misery than in any other country in the world. The name of that disease is bronchitis.
We went into a street in Salford on an apparently foggy morning. Actually, it was dry ice. And out of every doorway, one after the other, came a coffin. Until we had, I think it was 30 or 40 coffins in the middle of the road. And the commentary said,
for every 3 people who die of lung cancer, bronchitis kills 4. For every 3 people who die on the roads, bronchitis kills 15.
That was the sort of way that they liked presenting. Started the show with a bang. The approach was really anti-Dimbleby. What we were fed up with was the complacent, well-mannered, middle-class programs like Panorama, and indeed This Week, always following, on the whole, the middle-of-the-road, conventional, decent line.
The patients are all female geriatrics. Some are physically ill, others are simply very old, shaky, but still aware. Most are incontinent. You breathe urine all the time you're there.
We did deliberately set out to champion the cause of the underdog in a variety of ways and to make sure that life was a little more just in the way that people were treated and institutions behaved.
It was always on the edge of what was acceptable.
Who is it?
We had more rows with the Independent Television Authority over World in Action than any other company with any other show. In fact, all the other companies put together.
On September the 30th, 1961, the BMJ carried a warning article on the serious side effects of Distival. It had been observed that the drug was causing peripheral neuritis, a wasting of the arm and leg muscles of patients.
British Broadcasting, it wasn't there to sell goods like the American system. It wasn't there to be an instrument of the state like Russia or France. It was simply there to educate, inform and entertain, and we had to make sure that information and education got as much prominence as entertainment, and that is what we tried our best to do.
Soviet television, too, was then enjoying a period of relative freedom. The Communist Party, under the leadership of Nikita Khrushchev, was currently dressed in more liberal guise. In 1962, during the 22nd Congress of the party, the first to be televised, he called for a new kind of communism.
It was transmitted live. He spoke in a very airy-fairy fashion. He began to improvise. Our generation, he said, would live under true communism. The clouds would part and the sun would come streaming through. He used the image of the sun lighting up the Kremlin. He made an incredible impact, like high priests had on the people of ancient Egypt. I was overwhelmed. I was so convinced that within 20 years communism would be realized that I went home to my wife and said, "Did you see that? We must have a child right now so it will live under communism." A year later, our daughter was born.
Добрый вечер, товарищ Шип. Сегодня в нашей студии находится наш дорогой гость, известный прогрессивный американский писатель Альберт Кан.
Journalists were limited in what they could say, but they were granted greater freedom in how they expressed themselves. The most radical program was Relay, an open-ended, unscripted discussion presented by Yuri Fokin, which often included guests from the other side of the Iron Curtain. Fokin became the Soviet Union's first television star.
Fokin was a legend, the first presenter to speak without a script. Fokin was the most popular news commentator. His television image, because of his bad leg, was loose and relaxed. Because of his leg, he was unable to adopt the usual stance, where the presenter sits rigid in the middle of the frame, sticking strictly and solemnly to the script. Fokin's posture was relaxed.
It was the first program on Soviet television to attract a huge audience because it wasn't governed by the clock.
It dealt with subjects which, how can I put it, one shouldn't really talk about.
Ну можно было, но не нужно было бы рассказывать.
I'm indeed very happy to have this opportunity to convey greetings to you from the Soviet televiewers.
The English-speaking Fokin studied Western television. The Soviet Union's top star based his performance on the archetypal Englishman, the man world in action loved to hate.
Мой выдающийся учитель это был Ричард Димблби.
My most influential teacher was Richard Dimbleby.
И я считаю, что вот это
I learned a lot from him.
Которое было у него, у Ричарда Димблби, когда он
His most remarkable quality was his ability to speak to kings and ordinary folk with the same respect, the same interest, whoever it was.
Одинаково интересно, с кем бы он ни разговаривал.
That we're hoping in the course of the next few minutes to see the first live television from Soviet Russia. In fact, probably from Moscow, and we hope from Moscow airport.
It was Richard Dimbleby who introduced the first live broadcast from the Soviet Union. BBC producers planned to broadcast the 1961 May Day parade, but got wind of a bigger story.
Here was a major Soviet achievement, first man in space. The man was coming back, and somehow a couple of guys and I ensured that the Soviet authorities would open up the link 17 days before May Day.
The arrival of the hero in Moscow.
I mean, it was a major event, and it was a real coup of the first order.
It's perhaps difficult for us to understand what this particular moment must mean for this man. And there is Mr. Khrushchev.
Major Gagarin.
Mr. Khrushchev embraces him.
There's certainly enthusiasm, and I can well understand why they feel so enthusiastic.
Three weeks later, Dimbleby was in Moscow for the parade itself, presided over by Mr. Khrushchev and the new Soviet hero, Yuri Gagarin.
Shaking the very ground that the Kremlin stands on in all its massive strength, crashing and rattling over the cobbles and sending up a great cloud of exhaust fumes and filling our ears with a din that drowns out the huge mass bands. It seems as though Moscow itself trembles as they go by.
It was frightening, it was impressive, and it was new and it was different for the first time, live pictures from Moscow on their big day.
The traffic wasn't all one way. Russians were allowed to report from Britain.
Good morning, Miss Lambert. May I have a word with you, please?
Yes, I'd love to. Anything I can tell you?
Oh, certainly. You have plenty of things to tell me.
Yuri Fokin was the first.
Mrs. Lambert, вы хорошо знаете старый Лондон.
But Russian broadcasting soon had a reporter permanently based in London.
And I've got with me Mr. Henry Trofimenko, Russian, Radio Moscow. And Mr. Trofimenko, what do you think of our campaign?
My feeling is that not the whole truth is being told during this election campaign.
I, as a foreign correspondent, my main task was to look into the seamy sides of life, say, in Britain. So you were ordered to make some more or less nasty reports.
Англичане часто упрекают нас в том, что мы, советские люди, до сих пор представляем себе Англию по Диккенсу. Этот упрек несправедлив, ибо все мы знаем, что сегодняшняя Англия – это не Англия времен Оливера Твиста.
Slowly down the line, our camera pans for the last time.
Not all Trofimenko's reports were critical, but coverage of less serious events often carried unexpected hazards. Covering the 1964 Miss World contest, Trofimenko was forced to edit the BBC broadcast for his Soviet audience.
It was the first time ever that this contest was shown on Soviet TV.
I'm Linda Lin from Free China.
The snag was that the girl that won the third prize was Miss Free China. To show it in Russia was a capital crime, I would say, you know. So my problem was how to cut out Miss Free China from every scene, even the group scene. But the BBC operators did a marvelous job.
Miss World 1964, Miss United Kingdom.
The winner and the second candidate appeared, but Miss Free China was totally cut out.
In America, too, television journalists were pushing back the boundaries, particularly in the Deep South, where they reported on the sensitive issue of racial discrimination.
Police also used dogs, motorcycles, even an armored car to break up Negro mobs who threw rocks around the park area.
I was shocked the first time I went south and saw these. Absolutely shocked. Well, and then what happened, I think, my shock, in effect, that same sense of shock, was transmitted all over America when they saw these pictures.
We're willing to be beaten for democracy, and you misuse democracy in the street. You beat people bloody in order that they will not have the privilege.
The invading television crews from the North were as welcome as the black protesters, and themselves became the target of Southern anger.
I think myself black, I'd be on TV every night.
Television was to turn Martin Luther King, a young Baptist minister, into a national figure.
I am convinced that the most potent weapon available to oppress people, yes, as they struggle for freedom and justice, is the weapon of nonviolence.
I always felt that one of the ironies of King in his nonviolent movement was that he needed violence. He needed it. And if he went into a town and nothing happened, nothing would get on television.
King took the civil rights movement to Birmingham, Alabama, where he knew the local police commissioner, Bull Connor, was easily provoked.
Now, they chose Birmingham, one, because it was perhaps the most segregated big city in the South at the time, but more important, it had Bull Connor. And they knew how Bull Connor would react. And Bull Connor reacted as though we were following a script.
Freedom! 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 Freedom!
If this had never been on the network news, if it had never been anything but newspaper stories, I think, and an occasional photograph, it wouldn't have done. It was television. It was seeing people treated in that way. It was seeing the policemen beat people. It was seeing people knocked down. It was seeing the dogs charge and bite people. It was seeing the hoses. It was seeing it and knowing that it had happened just the day before.
Politicians could no longer afford to ignore the issue.
Now the time has come for this nation to fulfill its promise. The events in Birmingham and elsewhere have so increased the cries for equality that no city...
But with legislation imminent, the Kennedy administration was to come to a premature end.
From Dallas, Texas, the flash, apparently official, President Kennedy died at 1 p.m. Central Standard Time, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, some 38 minutes ago.
Nobody went to church. They went to their television sets. And the whole country held hands and they said, Father Cronkite, tell us everything's going to be all right.
Vice President Lyndon Johnson has left the hospital in Dallas, but we do not know to where he has proceeded. Presumably, he will be taking the oath of office shortly and become the 36th President of the United States.
The casket bearing the body of the late President now emerges into the sunshine.
I think the greatest picture I've ever seen was the picture of young JFK coming out of the church and saluting the casket of his father. I think it was a time when Americans really stood together and television provided a national church where they could worship together.
When I was told about the silence in the streets, that people weren't driving, they weren't walking, they were very little business was being done, everyone was glued to television, that was the first time I sensed the impact of what we had done. And I said to myself, I'm glad I don't work for a newspaper, because if all of America is watching all of this, what's left to write about?
The coverage of the Kennedy assassination and funeral increased the stature of network news. But Kennedy's death marked the end of the love affair between television and the presidency. It was the war in Vietnam which strained the relationship to breaking point. Believing the war to be a pushover, the American government allowed the press corps unrestricted access. It was a generosity the administration came to regret. Fighting the Viet Cong was one thing, taking on television was quite another.
This is what the war in Vietnam is all about.
The first skirmish between press and presidency followed a report by CBS's Morley Safer.
The Marines have burned this old couple's cottage because fire was coming from here.
Did you set fire to these houses here?
No, we were just out to the left.
I got a call from a friend at the embassy who said the shit is hitting the fan on this. Just so you know.
The day's operation burned down 150 houses, wounded three women, killed one baby, wounded one Marine, and netted these four prisoners. Four old men who could not answer questions put to them in English.
I got a telephone call from Arthur Sylvester, who was Assistant Secretary of Defense for Public Affairs. And he called to raise holy hell with me because he said, I've never seen a story worse than that, and I'm surprised that you and CBS News, as a supposedly responsible news organization, could dream of putting that on the air.
As the war ground on, television brought the full horror, now in color, into every home.
We were unable to be able to counter the squalid, bloody depictions on the screen of young men getting blown away every night of every week. And there is no counter rebuttal to that.
The enemy's well-coordinated attacks occurred throughout South Vietnam, but the most dramatic demonstration of his boldness came at the very symbol of America's presence in Vietnam, the brand new U.S. Embassy building there. CBS News correspondent Robert...
Television coverage of the Viet Cong's Tet Offensive in 1968 seemed to present an enduring image of American failure.
Before that, a platoon of Viet Cong were in control.
Tet, as a military operation, was a total disaster for the Viet Cong. They lost 40,000 people. But all the American public remembered was that picture of the U.S. Embassy in Saigon where one or two Viet Cong guerrillas were able to penetrate the wall before they were killed.
If the communist intention was to take and seize the cities, they came closer here at Hue than
the Tet Offensive seemed so disastrous that anchor Walter Cronkite flew out to deliver his own on-the-spot report.
Here on the new side of the city. By the time we'd gotten to Tet, I was very concerned that our military was not telling us the full truth of the nature of our involvement that we were overcommitted.
But it was Cronkite's end-of-program editorial that caused most damage.
It is increasingly clear to this reporter that the only rational way out then will be to negotiate, not as victors,
but as an honorable people who lived up to their pledge to defend democracy and did the best they could. This is Walter Cronkite. Good night.
For President Lyndon Johnson, that editorial was probably the breaking point.
I told him what Cronkite had said, I think one morning, and he made the comment to me that if he had lost Cronkite, he'd probably lost the people.
I shall not see, and I will not accept the nomination of my party for another term as your president.
I think that he was at the breaking point when we did our report, as I say, maybe a very small straw on his back.
Thank you for listening. Good night, and God bless all of you.
The war dragged on, and opposition to it increased. Pictures of demonstrations dominated news and current affairs programs throughout the world.
The 60s was the... when I think about it, it was almost above all the period of student unrest. I mean, all over the world. And this was largely, I think, because of the Vietnam War, it radicalized students all over the world.
The demonstrators have chosen the most logical possible place this time to hold their protest. The Pentagon is, in one very important respect, the greatest power center in the world. It's the control room of the mighty...
The hippie world, with its love beads and karma bells, its wilting flowers and firm convictions, was well represented.
The hippies were very much in the forefront of this, and they actually formed a massive ring around the Pentagon, all holding hands. And there they were. There was the National Guard holding their rifles, and there were hippies with their bunches of flowers.
And if the crowd had been any less good-tempered, they would certainly have made mincemeat of the troops and the marshals. Instead, they contented themselves with planting pink carnations in the barrels of the soldiers' rifles.
...3:45, 15,000 people begin their march on the American embassy.
In Britain, the biggest demonstration took place in Grosvenor Square. World in Action covered it like a rock concert with six camera crews.
5:20, Grosvenor Square. The riot you will see is the most violent London can remember.
I felt personally mostly scared, actually. It was, as the commentary says, the most violent civil disturbance which had taken place in Britain, I think, since Peterloo. It was just very difficult to work because the cameras at that time were still joined by an umbilical cord to the tape recorders. So we kept kind of being wound round one another in a situation that would have been hilarious if it hadn't been so uncomfortable. It was a Sunday afternoon event for Monday transmission, so we generated 20,000 feet of film, caught the train back to Manchester, and I sat in one cutting room and cut half the film. And one of my colleagues sat in another cutting room and cut the other half of the film, and we joined them up. I think getting them into telecine and onto television with something like 30 seconds to spare.
Rock musicians were in the vanguard of the anti-war movement, and were now taken as seriously as political leaders.
The singer is American superstar Jim Morrison, leader of a Californian rock and roll band called The Doors. To them, he is poet, prophet, and politician.
You know we gotta get it all together.
Like many of their contemporaries, The Doors show more clearly what they're against rather than what they're for. This film is an attempt to illustrate their report on the state of the world. The Doors' message is uncompromisingly loud. Please do not adjust your set.
We want the world and we want it!
I guess some of us bought into the notion that Jim Morrison might have things to say which were of relevance and meaning. time, Jim Morrison seemed as viable a witness as Edward Heath.
Mick Jagger, the Rolling Stones leader, sentenced to jail a month ago on drugs charges, is free. Earlier today, he won his appeal against the prison sentence, and tonight he flew by helicopter to an outside broadcast location 30 miles from London to appear in World in Action. Publicity since the case has shown up a split between the society which resents the...
This was very much a subject of interest to people in my generation. There was a sense that this was an example of the state oppressing youth culture.
Mick, you've had a difficult day, and you've had a difficult 3 months, to put it mildly. Do you think that the society that you live in is one you ought to rebel against, or do you think you're rebelling against it?
Yes, definitely rebelling against it. I mean, not in the obvious way that a newspaper or pop sort of headline would do it.
It didn't match one's hopes and expectations. A rather stilted dialogue took place between the generations, which didn't get very far, but the programme had great symbolic importance at the time. And did my career no harm at all.
Close your eyes, count to ten, think of me again, but don't you talk to him.
Even Soviet television couldn't ignore the growing influence of pop music.
Thank you very much, Cliff.
Though Henry Trofimenko chose a more clean-cut example.
Нам еще ни разу не приходилось выступать перед советской аудиторией. Но мы надеемся, что мы сможем посетить вашу страну и лично выступить перед вами. Это наше заветное желание.
I hope you'll come someday and you'll be most welcome. And thank you very much, Vance.
Thank you very much indeed.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. That was great.
Cliff wouldn't have found the Soviet Union receptive. In 1964, Khrushchev had been deposed by the hardline Leonid Brezhnev. When Henry Trofimenko returned to Moscow, he found the mood in television had changed for the worse.
It was a different atmosphere, I would say. Different atmosphere, in fact, for political commentators. And I decided to leave because I didn't want, you see, to be a sort of a parrot, really, because it was very, very difficult to say something original, even to write some original comment or to look at differently. It was a sheer adulation and adoration of Brezhnev, you know.
This evening, by using satellites...
The thaw in international relations had been replaced by an icy wind. Soviet producers were forced by their bosses to pull out of the worldwide satellite extravaganza, Our World.
Our World was going to circle the globe for the first time. Now, it won't quite do that. Because for political reasons, the Russians and a few other countries have withdrawn. It's a pity, but there it is. And now we can cover two-thirds instead of all the world.
Когда эта передача пошла в эфир,
the program came on the air, and there were tears in my eyes as I sat in the studio and watched the broadcast from Helsinki. It was terrible. It was a dreadful mistake.
Это было ужасно. Это был жуткий просчет.
Внимание! Говорит космодром.
Journalists who prospered under the old regime fell out of favor with the new. Though Yuri Fokin kept his job reporting on Soviet efforts in space, the first Soviet television star found himself sidelined.
The programs I made as a political commentator were always, without exception, scheduled outside prime time.
Короче говоря, я понял, что я стал.
In short, I realized that whilst not exactly an outcast, I was clearly out of favor.
Изгоем, то по крайней мере человеком, который находится в явном дисфаворе.
Добрый вечер, товарищи.
Добрый вечер.
Pride of place in the new schedules went to Vremya, which means time in English. The party leadership kept a close eye on the output. There was a compensation. The news now went out in a regular fixed slot, broadcast on both networks at once. Vremya was the centrepiece of the evening's viewing.
Vremya captured 98% of viewers. The most avid viewers were the leaders themselves. His timetable was arranged so that by 9 o'clock Brezhnev arrived home. They'd say, hurry, Vremya is starting, and he would sit down and watch.
Vremya was probably the most heavily staffed and lavishly resourced news program in the world. The program's producers very rarely had to ask twice for the latest equipment.
At worst, we could say if we met Brezhnev, look at the camera we're filming with. Then there would be trouble. Everyone knew that. I myself told the director of planning, we really must buy these two cameras the Japanese have brought over. They're not expensive, only $300,000. However, we've spent all our money. He said, no problem, more will be forthcoming.
Vremya was relayed to distant parts of the Soviet Union by satellite, a decade before programs were carried in a similar way in the West. For the next 20 years, it was the dominant Soviet television program, laying down the party line and helping to hold together a diverse empire.
There was very little that was critical. However, on a social level, people were delighted with it. Here were all these members of a huge family in a country spread across 11,000 kilometers, linked by television. Everyone knew that everyone watched Vremya. We felt a sense of kinship with our friends and fellow countrymen.
In Britain, programme makers continued to explore new ways of presenting difficult one. The BBC broadcast what was conceived to be a groundbreaking film about politics, Yesterday's Men. One of
yesterday's men. The idea simply came to me in a very sort of, at a very personal level. It would be interesting to look at what it's like to lose office when you don't expect it, and what you do with your time and how you adapt to it.
What have you done to supplement your income?
Writing.
Mainly writing?
Writing and, talking to chaps like Dimbleby on the television, things like that.
Dimbleby talked to prominent members of the previous Labour government about how they were coping in reduced circumstances.
Well, I've done television. Look, I'm doing it now.
Only Harold Wilson became richer in opposition. Using his privileged access to government papers, he wrote 300,000 words in 6 months.
But Harold Wilson refused to answer questions about the proceeds from the serialisation of a recent book. The BBC agreed to drop the offending section of the interview, and this is the first time it's been seen.
I get a salary as leader of the opposition.
You couldn't set our minds at rest on the vexed question of what the Sunday Times did actually pay for the book?
No, I don't think it's a matter of interest to the BBC or to anybody else.
Had Dimbleby said, look, we'd like to discuss your money, not that he had much, but had Dimbleby said that, Wilson could have said, yeah, okay, fine, or no, I'm not going to. But to come to speak on one subject and then talk to another is cheating.
It's a ridiculous question to put. Yes, and I mean it cut off. I don't want to read in the Times diary on Miss Helen that I asked for it to be cut out.
Can I ask you this then, which, I mean, let me put this question. I mean, if you find this question offensive,
to ask then, if your curiosity can be satisfied, it's disgraceful.
It broke out into a row between Dimbleby and Wilson. I tried to stop the filming of it.
Never had such a question in an interview in my life before.
Well, let's stop it now and talk about it.
No, let's. Well, I can keep going.
And I thought I had, but of course they kept the tape running.
I think we'll have a new piece of film and it'll start all over again. But if this film is used or if this is leaked, then there's going to be a hell of a row.
The Labour Party tried unsuccessfully to stop the programme being broadcast. They said they'd agreed to a serious film about the role of Her Majesty's opposition, but had been conned into something far more demeaning.
During the last year, Mr. Wilson has been criticised for his lackluster performance in the House and on television. And if there's at present no direct challenge to his leadership, there are contenders waiting in the wings, and some who would certainly like to see him go.
It really was a scandalous political programme. And that, I think, for Wilson, demonstrated for all time that there was a bias in the BBC. It had its repercussions. From that moment on, I decided that Wilson would never be interviewed by David Dimbleby again.
If the big red bus knocked old Harold down, they'd be rubbing their hands with sorrow.
Yesterday's Men was a watershed. After a decade of pushing back the boundaries, television was now approaching the limits of what was acceptable. The programme brought to the surface the underlying tension between broadcasters and politicians.
You see, the arrogance of power had got to them. They believed they could control the BBC's journalism. They thought that when we came to do interviews with them, it would just be on their terms. And the difference with Yesterday's Men was it was the first attempt, not in any particularly outrageous or sensational way, to change that rule and not just to sit there and lap it up. And that's what they didn't like. They didn't like the fun, to tell the truth, in Yesterday's Men.
From NBC News, Election Central. A special one-hour edition of the news, reported by Chet Huntley and David Brinkley.
Nixon's the one. That's the natural banner for any sprightly front page tonight.
1968, Nixon was back, this time the winner, this time as president. But his failure to win in 1960 had left him deeply suspicious of the television networks.
Richard Nixon's view was that the people who were covering him, print and television, by and large, were very liberal, came from democratic backgrounds, were hostile to him personally as well as to the Republican Party, and there were almost no exceptions to that.
And so tonight, to you, the great silent majority of my fellow Americans,
he decided to appeal directly to the viewer in order to avoid interruption by critical interviewers.
To end the war in a way that we could win the peace.
With me in our CBS studios are my colleagues, CBS diplomatic correspondent Marvin Calvin.
But he was outflanked. The network news spoilt the impact by subjecting his speeches to instant analysis.
Well, first, Dan, I'm not sure, but it seemed to me first that the speech cut no new ground. It seemed a soft-spoken, straight...
Nixon exploded, went into a series of epithets which I will not use, called me, of all things, a Romanian agent. God knows where he came up with that one. And he sicked his government on me, which meant IRS checks, that is your income tax, would be checked every single year. My telephone was tapped. My office was broken into. I was tailed when I covered stories. It was a mess.
Nixon then let his vice president, Spiro Agnew, loose.
Perhaps it is time that the networks were made more responsive to the views of the nation and more responsible to the people they serve.
I was asked my reaction to Spiro Agnew, and I said he's full of crap. I got back to New York and Reuben Frank, the president of NBC News, called me in and said, why did you have to say Agnew was full of crap? I said, you want another synonym?
Lists of unfriendly reporters were drawn up, reminiscent of the communist witch hunt 20 years earlier. Pressure was placed on the networks not to hire them.
Well, I got on the enemy's list. I couldn't get work in television or print for 3 years. And finally, when I was named on the enemies list, my two sons thought it was a great honor. I said, well, considering the fact your father has not been able to find work in 3 years, it's an honor without profit in my own land.
The Watergate affair, escalating finally into charges of a high-level campaign of political sabotage and espionage.
The scandal surrounding the Watergate burglary brought Nixon down.
Most of what is known of the Watergate affair has emerged in puzzling bits and pieces through digging by the nation's press and television newsmen.
Mr. Danielson.
Aye.
Mr. Drynan.
Aye.
Though the original story broke in the press, it was television coverage that boosted its impact and kept it firmly in the public eye, ensuring it turned into a crisis for the presidency.
27 members have voted aye. 11 members have voted no.
And with that vote, Mr. Nixon became the first president in more than a century, and only the second in all of our history, to confront removal from office through the only means provided in the Constitution, impeachment.
I think freedom of the press, freedom of the broadcast media to report what they are should report under the First Amendment of the Constitution would have been curtailed. I don't know how far it would have been, but I think there would have been actions of the government. I think we would have lost freedom of the press to some extent if Watergate had not occurred.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow. Vice President Ford will be sworn in as president at that hour in this office.
Now we see the president leaving a bit sooner than we expected, accompanied by Vice President Gerald Ford, who will become the 38th president of the United
States. Nixon went, serenaded on television by those he despised, his departure providing another great moment on the medium which had so affected his career.
Rustling the leaves of the magnolia trees that Andrew Jackson planted.
For the past 15 years, television had helped make and break presidents. The wind was about to blow in the other direction.
And on its way to Andrews Air Force Base, a trip that will take only a few minutes.
Sampling life as directors, two theatre critics are put through their paces in The Works, next on BBC Two.